Hello, and welcome to the 9th episode of Fess Up, the video podcast for female maskers. I'm Rogue.
And I'm Kerry. Yes, it looks like we're finally getting out of quarantine and everything and going back to normal. And we're going to try to start making episodes more often. We got a great episode for you. We have a very interesting video that Rogue created. We have a really good interview with an exciting masker. And we hope you enjoy our latest show.
We like to begin each podcast with a catch-up on what we've been doing recently that we call Fess Up. So what have you been up to recently, Kerry?
Watching a lot of TV with my cat. Actually, mask orders have picked up. It was kind of quiet last year. And suddenly, everybody wants an emerald latex mask. And that's something I've been in butter for, 20 years. And they never go into fashion, and suddenly everybody wants one.
That was the one that was designed by Paul Barrett Brown, wasn't it?
Yes, who famously made the Catwoman costume in Batman Returns. I also decided at the end of the year to stop making silicone masks. Basically, I had so many, tastes changed, people moved on, and so I decided to, I had a good run with those things, but I'm going to focus on latex masks, which is kind of where the money is.
Go with what works, and it is a double-edged sword. It's nice to see so many other manufacturers on the market selling silicone masks, but it is kind of hurting the independent artist who's out there trying to make it work.
Yeah, I only had two styles, and most of the places, have tons of them. But I do like the fact that I was the first person to have a mask torso combo, and the Susan mask in his day was a really good seller. I made a lot of money on that, so I got no complaints.
Your history is secured.
So how about you, Rob?
Well, a friend asked me recently, have I been doing any new costumes? The short answer is yes. The long answer is yes. So around this time last year, I really started getting into the Witcher series of video games.
The Witcher's a video game?
Yes, Kerry. The Witcher is a video game. Somewhere a gamer fairy just died.
I've never played a video game. Sue me.
It's more than the Netflix series. So I was really enamored with the Yennefer costume, and I found a vendor online who was selling that, and they did a really wonderful job with the outfit, especially the coat. It's fantastic. But I didn't care so much for the gloves, so I ended up making my own gloves and the fur around the gloves and everything else, and I was really happy with how it came out. Around this time, I was also working on modifying a dress that I had made that I call the X dress, where I had tried to combine superhero elements into modern clothing. And I shortened this dress from when I had created it previously and showed it on this podcast, and I like it better at this length. I'm also wearing a new mask in this photo. This is a tailor mask from KreaFX.
What'd you think of the KreaFX mask?
I really like the silicone that they're using. It's an EcoFlex style, for those who know what that is. It's very soft, very comfortable to wear, but that's kind of also the drawback, unfortunately. It makes the face very soft in the features. They aren't well-defined because of the softness of the silicone. It also tends to open up the eye holes really large, and I had to correct that myself by reinforcing the eyes, and I was able to make it look nice. But it wasn't something I could just buy and wear and make it look nice. I had to do a significant amount of work to it.
Yeah, Rob was nice enough to lend me the tailor mask for a few minutes so I could pop it on. I've never seen one in person. I didn't know how well they fit. And I didn't want to spend $700 to find out they didn't. And basically, it was way too small for me. I mean, the features were all stretched out. The ears were, right here on me. It was way too small for a big-headed girl like me. But on some people, it looks amazing, but not for me.
Then a little later in the year, I decided to purchase the 5th season version of the Supergirl outfit from the TV series. And again, a wonderful outfit, but the boots weren't quite right. I usually find when I purchase these, there's one or two little things that I think I can make better. So I was able to modify the boots and make them work better. And overall, it came out really nice. And then around the holidays, I purchased a green dress, which is the one that I wore on that holiday message that we did. Very 50s looking style, but really cute.
That is the last time I'm going to let Rogue wear a green dress because it plays havoc with our green screen behind us.
Live and learn. Then when the new year started, I saw the new Wonder Woman movie and decided I really wanted to have that golden armor, and somebody online was selling it. So I purchased the entire outfit, which you can see here, and included some what they call Isis wings to give me that full wing effect. I haven't found any vendor who's trying to sell the wings. But I really like this outfit. It feels great when you wear it. You really feel like you're wearing some armor, but it's not uncomfortable. They did a great job making that outfit. What did you think of that Wonder Woman movie?
Well, I know that some commentators had a problem with the fact that Chris Pine inhabits this poor guy's body and then Diana has sex with him. And they're like, if it had been the other way around, that would have been a bit creepy. I didn't really notice that when I was watching the movie, but I will say that I thought the Mandalorian, I mean Pedro Pascal, was a really weak villain. He just, you know, he wasn't very good at all. And my opinion is that in superhero movies like James Bond films, the better the villain, the better the hero. And he was just a wet noodle. I wish the whole movie had been with Cheetah instead.
Yeah, unfortunately, the sequel does tend to suffer from having too many villains. And maybe you're right. Maybe just focusing on Cheetah would have been a better choice. It's a very comic book story, and Max Lord does appear in the comic series. In fact, Wonder Woman actually kills Max Lord in the comic. That didn't happen in the movie. But for fans of the comic, we were wondering if that was going to happen or not until we actually saw the film. Spoiler alert.
That movie also hurt the fact that the first one was so good that expectations were high. And even though it's not a bad movie, I enjoyed it. But it's just not as good as the first one.
It was also fun to see Cheetah on the big screen and compare it to the Wonder Woman and Cheetah that we did a few years ago for our podcast.
Yeah.
And also there's a particular scene where Cheetah grabs Wonder Woman's lasso and tosses her into a wall. We did a very similar thing in our video, so it was nice to justify that that could actually happen.
And our budget was a little bit smaller than theirs was.
For sure. And then we got into the new year, and there were several other outfits that caught my eye, including a Power Girl. Panther Ann Tamakami from Persona 5, a video game. Black Canary, the classic version with the fishnets. A Spider Woman.
Hey, good old territory there. Spider Woman was the very first outfit I ever made, because back in those days, you couldn't just buy them off the rack. You had to make them yourself.
Well, now you can. And I like the way they made it, but the stitching under the arms with the webbing was just stitched, and it wasn't very visible. So I was able to improve it by adding my own vinyl and really made that pop more. And a character, a villain from Sailor Moon called Tin Nayanko. I just loved the outfit. It was so cute. It's black and red, and that's a color scheme that always speaks to me. So had to get it. But I didn't just buy costumes. I also made several outfits, including this blue dress that I made from a McCall's pattern, 7625. It had some really interesting gathering around the side and lots of buttons up and down the front, and it looked like a fun engineering challenge, so I had fun making that one. My wife also came across a large roll of pink vinyl, which was gifted to her, and she didn't have a use for, so she said I could do something with it. And boy, for me, that was like catnip. So I found a pattern that was based on actually a Black Canary outfit with a short coat and skirt. And so I made that outfit, but then also made my own circle skirt as well.
Cool. Okay, so tell me about the costume you're wearing today.
This is Miranda Lawson from the Mass Effect series of games. She's sometimes jokingly referred to as the cheerleader because she's genetically modified to look physically perfect. Mass Effect recently had a re-release, the Legendary Edition, and so it's on a lot of people's minds. And I was always wanting to make this outfit, but finding that hexagonal white pattern was always a challenge. So when I found that somebody had done it as a bodysuit, I thought that would be a good base to start from. So that is underneath, and then I made my own coat that goes on top, including the gloves and belt and boot. I made them a little more three-dimensional so they actually pop and stand out.
And what kind of mask are you wearing this time?
This is a Dream Mask from Dream Mask, and it's a Hathaway version of the Dream Mask. I really like it. It's got really nice features. It's a little stiffer than the Cree FX, so the silicone is still soft and comfortable, but it holds its features a little better.
You've been pretty busy there, Rogue.
Well, like Taylor Swift sings, can't stop, won't stop.
True enough. Now for Speak Up, where we answer your questions. I'm here that we've gotten from our comments, and Rogue's not seen these questions before. She doesn't know what I'm going to ask her. Jade Dow wonders, how do you decide on what you're going to chat about in your videos?
Well, we came upon a format after discussing before the very first episode, and we decided what we wanted to share and what the format of the show should be, so we pretty much stuck to that since the beginning. But of course, we're open to suggestions. If there's something that you'd like us to add to the show, please let us know.
Yeah, we kind of have an outline for each show, like we're going to talk about this type of thing under each category, stuff like that. And, you know, we mainly just sort of ad-lib it and kind of see how it turns out. So that's pretty much it. You know, I think that's happening that's relevant. We kind of throw into that show. Olaf Hunshammer asks, do you want to be a girl? Well, I'll fucking answer that. No, I like dressing like a girl, but I prefer being a man.
Yes, for me, it's a costuming challenge. And I've mentioned before, I just don't want to limit myself as a costumer. I do plenty of male costumes and female costumes. And I just decided I will be entering in a competition coming up, which I'm going to be doing a female costume. But I've won many awards for doing male costumes as well. It's just, I like the freedom to do anything I want.
Marie Clinton asks me, I wonder how did you react to that original Emma Sophia edit, by the way? Were you aware of it when it happened? Did you ever make a statement or react to that before? She's referring to the most popular video on my YouTube channel, which now has 1.5 million views, and it's me showing off my Susan mask, and at the end I take it off. And somebody digitally then changed it so it looked like Emma Watson was unmasking. And that video went crazy viral several years ago. So much so that I still get hundreds of views every day because it links to my original video for that. And I certainly was aware of it when it happened because I was getting a lot of views and a lot of interest. My reaction was it was an interesting use of that. And the fact that they, you know, gave credit to me, okay, if they just stole the video and used it, I would have not been very happy with that. But, you know, they acknowledged it was mine, and, you know, it gets people to come look at my site, and maybe one or two of you have even subscribed because you thought, oh, this is kind of cool.
Well, that was the very early days of the deepfake videos, and now we've seen quite a bit more. Do you think there'll be more people just using CGI to do unmasking scenes in the future?
I see people using CGI for actual videos on Twitter that superimpose faces or in particular their eyes, and it's all fake. And usually they say, look, this is a fake video, I'm not really doing this. And so it's getting crazy, but, you know, for us, it's no fun at all. I mean, we actually like the idea of how you mask and stuff like that. If you're going to use CGI, what's the point?
Yeah, it's much less of a challenge. I mean, if we can pull it off practically, which is what they call when you're using a makeup effect, it's much more of a challenge and much more exciting to see.
Well, that's what we're interested in doing. Knox Productions is a question for me, and I guess you. For one of your future segments, would you ever consider where Rogue chooses your outfit and mask and vice versa?
Well, probably not. I think I have helped Kerry with some style suggestions in the past and made some suggestions for outfits. But I like to choose what I'm going to wear.
Yeah, it's true. I hate shopping, and often I'll just say, Rogue, I don't know what to wear next time. And she'll send me links to various dresses, and I'll choose one. This time I actually picked this out myself. This is $20 at Target. Saw it there a couple of weeks ago and picked it up for the show. And yeah, Rogue's got enough ideas for costumes and stuff like that, so she doesn't need any help from me, and I wouldn't have an idea how to dress her anyway. I really dress myself. I don't want to dress anybody else. That's too much work. One of our biggest fans, Susie Nails, comments, again, great episode. I love Rogue's cosplays, and I really enjoyed the interview with Iris. And don't worry about the release schedule. I've got my notifications on, so I always know when new episodes drop. Susie, you are our kind of fan. All the best to you, and happy 25th anniversary of your website, Kerry. Oh, so just a nice comment there. You're always saying, we don't get enough feedback. Well, there's some really great feedback there.
Yeah, thank you, Susie. It's great to hear from you, and thanks for your nice comments.
The Masked Geo commented on our last show, love the episode, guys. Love your outfit, Rogue. I'm a big fan of Daphne, and I've always wanted to find a really cool outfit that stays true to her original design, and I think you've done a really good job pulling it off.
Thank you.
I also really love Doctor Who, and I love the video you made. Thank you very much. I also really appreciated the message behind it, as I feel it's an accurate description of our world at the moment, which may have also had a bit of a head nod to the taboo nature of female masking. Keep up the great work, guys. Just the kind of feedback we'd love to get. Thank you very much.
Yes, we love all things fandom, so that's why you have the spectrum from Scooby-Doo to Doctor Who. That runs. We're also interested in just expanding the horizon of the acceptance for this type of costuming, this type of expression. I think that there are a lot of people who are interested in this based on what we hear, but then the acceptance amongst the general public has been limited. So presenting it in a nice way is what we're trying to do. Hopefully we'll gain more acceptance.
If you haven't figured out already, that pretty much is the rant and denture of this entire podcast. Bright Boy says, when will you do a face reveal? You've been hiding your face for about 13, 14 years now, I think. Well, actually, it's more like double that, like 26 years. And I've got to be honest, it might be another 26 years, because that's not what we do on this show. So, sorry.
There are some people who would like a magician to reveal how they do their trick. and the rest of them would like to just enjoy the magic trick. So I'm sorry, but our presentation is all you're going to get.
Yeah. Anyway, if you have a question, please put it in the comment section below, and we may answer it on our next show.
The next segment is makeup, where we share some techniques on how to make your mask look their best. Now, most masks come in three different designs. There's the full head, the head with the neck, and the head, neck, and chest. Now, for people who have a mask with a neck, it often bunches up when you turn because it isn't secure to your body. So I'd like to show a technique for how to correct that. When a mask has just a neck section and it isn't secured somehow to the body, it floats freely and can create unusual and sometimes painful looking bunching when you turn your head. To eliminate this, I connect the neck to a short fabric shirt underneath so that it will hold and move naturally. I begin with a short tank style shirt, and I sew my own from beige fabric, but you can use a light colored, well-fitting shirt if you don't have any sewing skills. It should fit you tightly, though. A loose shirt won't help very much. If you have access to a sculpting bust or a wig stand with shoulders, it makes the next part far easier. Place the shirt onto the bust and then place the mask over it. What this does is stretch out the fabric to get the correct shape to attach to your mask. I use GE Silicone 1 Clear Caulking to attach the fabric to the mask. Simply lift up a corner of the mask and apply some caulking to the underside of the mask. Press that down onto the fabric with a bit of firmness to spread the caulking and then allow it to dry. Continue with this process all along the bottom of the mask to attach it to the fabric. When you're done, the fabric will hold the neck of your mask in place when you turn your head, and it won't float or twist unnaturally any longer. And you can also insert breast forms into the fabric like a tube top, and that will help hold them in place. One additional makeup tip I'd like to share. One manufacturer of silicone masks, who shall remain nameless, wanted to charge $100 to have punched eyebrows on their masks, and I thought that was really excessive. I found on Amazon a pair of artificial eyebrows that were only $20, and my technique was to add a little bit of silicone to the back of these eyebrows and then attach it to a mask. And it looks almost as good as punched eyebrows, and it was only $20. Us girls have to save money where we can, right?
Yeah, these are really good suggestions, Rogue. My masks are so thick that I don't really have that neck punching problem, but on thinner masks, I definitely see that quite a bit. And if you follow our tips there, it really can help improve your look. So give it a try. Now for a segment called Heads Up, where we talk about masking in the media. Well, you've all seen those reality shows there, especially The Masked Singer, where they're wearing these big elaborate costumes. But in Europe, there's a whole genre of shows where people actually dress up as famous people, and using prosthetics and sometimes even masks. Now, a recent German show, Big Performance, featured someone in a Jennifer Lopez appliance that she then peeled off at the end of real singer Vanessa May on stage. So it was a really good makeup, and it was a very good disguise.
It's fun to see the behind the scenes as well, where they show some of the makeup being done or being removed, so people can get a sense for how that's done. But they also create a very impressive effect on stage.
Yeah, it's kind of cool to see that, especially when she took it off on camera.
Well, I found a video feature on the CNN website that I wanted to highlight because it involved masking, but it was really poorly done, and it really reinforced some negative stereotypes, so I wanted to talk about that.
Okay.
The reporter, and I use that term loosely, was commenting on a manufacturer in Japan who was selling hard resin face masks. The reporter cites the Mission Impossible movies, which use a silicone prosthetic, to compare it to these hard resin masks, as if they're even comparable, which in terms of realism, they are not. The basic premise of this piece is just so flawed, since the assumption is that this Japanese mask is somehow new and worth reporting on, that there have been hard resin face masks available on the market for many years now. In fact, we commented on them previously on this very podcast in episode number 5 when we were discussing the poster for the movie Us. Now, a diligent reporter might have considered researching what's actually available before assuming that this was something new. So where are the stories on the amazing silicone masks that are actually new and much closer to the Mission Impossible masks that she's referring to? Also, the reporter just injected several buzzwords into her piece which were demeaning and derogatory, including calling the mask creepy twice, referencing Silence of the Lambs, and highlighting only negative online comments for the masks. Now, I find it hard to believe that there were no positive comments that she could have included for the sake of a balanced story. The original video also doesn't even appear to have been filmed by her network, but rather was some video taken from a Japanese TV news report and edited. I found the original Japanese report online, and it showed the shop owner also wearing a female face. And that was something CNN chose to edit out of their report. So this was a prime example of a lazy reporter just phoning it in.
I like CNN because I agree with their politics, but their website is pure clickbait. And I'm not terribly surprised that they repurpose a news story they found from the foreign media and did their own spin on it. You know, they're not so much journalism as content creators, and they're trying to make it as sensationalist as possible to get the most reaction from things. And I'm so used to this sort of stuff. I mean, back in the 70s, they used to cover, like, Star Trek convention and be like, look at these weirdos in their costumes! And the anchors would all laugh about that. Who got the last laugh? But yeah, I agree. It was definitely lazy journalism.
And just, you know, it kind of angered me a little bit that they chose to take this negative viewpoint of it and focus their entire story on it that way. It's just, there's enough anger in the world right now. Do we really need to be doing that as well? It's very frustrating.
Well, that's why we're out here trying to create a positive image.
Yes. The next segment of our show is Show Up, where we recreate something from the media, or, in this case, create a new video. Hope you enjoy.
It's been a cold winter so far. But some nights, like this, it's not the cold and the damp that gets to me. It's the chill I get from knowing that for somebody out there, this is probably their last night on Earth. Maybe it's a jilted lover. Maybe it's just some bum on the street. They all had dreams once, but this city takes those dreams and turns them to ashes.
Sebastian?
Yes?
My name is Louis Vanderbeek, and I need your help.
What seems to be the problem?
I'm afraid someone's gonna try to kill my sister.
Why do you think she's in danger?
I've been having an affair with her husband. I'm so ashamed. But I know that he really loves me, and not my sister.
Go on.
He made them both take out large insurance policies. I'm afraid he's gonna do something rash.
Like rub her out and collect the insurance and then run away with you?
Exactly.
I think you're lying.
Excuse me?
I'm guessing it was your idea to get those insurance policies for you and your husband. You've known about their affair for a while now, am I right? I'll bet you even have a plan to get rid of them. And you needed me to be a patsy for your alibi.
So ashamed. How did you know?
Simple. Big butt. Little butt.
Thanks. I'll have to remember that for next time. Now for something we call All Dolled Up. We talk about the making of that video. So what inspired you to make that video, Rogue?
Well, back in 2006, I was really inspired by the movie Sin City, which was a black and white noir movie, and thought it would be fun to create a webcomic, and I asked Kerry to help me with that. So we did a two-page webcomic featuring a character I created called Sarah Finn, a female detective, which is a play on words of the angel Seraphim. When we were talking about what feature to film next, I thought, well, let's see if we can bring that to life. So it's essentially the same story, but we made some slight changes to it.
You know, normally the show is face up, and you ended up face down.
Oh, ow.
Bad joke time.
Well, I had originally hoped to find an office location where we could film this, but unfortunately, during COVID time, it was really hard to find shooting space. So it ended up being a hotel room. I hope it didn't look too much like a hotel room. We tried to make it look like an office. That's a little behind the scenes. Yeah, I was also curious just to try a black and white feature, just to see how the masks would look under those conditions.
Yeah, speaking of which, one of the masks I was wearing is my Susan mask, which I call Crack Whore Susan, because the makeup is not painted by me, but somebody else. And it's really over the top, and in color, it just looks garish. But in black and white, it looks great! You know, if you can't figure out the video, I mean, can you explain the history there? It might be so confusing to people, because it goes by so fast.
It is a bit of an in-joke for us. So, when we first met, it was at a convention, and Kerry and I were both in costume, and a nice lady came up to us and complimented us on our outfits and said, "I know which one of you is a boy and which one's a girl." She pointed at us and said, "Big butt, little butt." At the time, I hadn't really been filling out the padding on my hips, so I have learned since to do that, but that in-joke made it into this video.
The idea is that the skinny sister is impersonating her big hip sister, and that's the clue that Seraphine makes to realize the mystery there, unmasks her, and then, you know, gets shot for all her trouble.
And normally when we film this segment talking about the feature, we wear the outfits that we filmed with. But in this case, I totally spaced on that, and I modified the dress that Lilith was wearing. It was such a beautiful superhero red that I thought, boy, wouldn't that make a great casual wear Wonder Woman? So I added the Wonder Woman logo to it and made an outfit, including the gold belt. I found a wonderful pair of shoes that were red with a white stripe and gave her a golden tiara headband. So just having fun, and I changed that outfit enough that I couldn't ask Kerry to wear it again for this segment. I'll try to remember next time.
Actually, I'm kind of glad, because just as I just said, I don't want to wear that mask in color. It's just, it's too over the top for daylight like this.
And I just had fun bringing that character to life from that comic version we did to an actual character. And who knows, you know, we didn't see her actually die. She could return again someday.
Maybe Lilith's just a bad shot.
Possibly.
Well, thanks for coming in, Sarah.
Thanks for having me.
Okay. Now, talk up, where we do an interview with someone. This time, Rogue has spoken to Avalon, a very talented mask and suit maker. So take a look.
Hello, Avalon. It's great to finally meet you. I've admired your work online for so many years now.
Equally nice. I mean, you had a bit of a head start on this, a bit along the years.
Can you tell us what country you're from and what the masking scene is like in that country?
Sweden. Which, being Sweden, it exists. Not really that densely populated country, so I mean, there are a few masked people here and there.
I really respect that you make the outfits yourself, and can you tell me about how you learned to make some of the outfits that you make?
Mistakes upon mistakes upon mistakes for 10 plus years. It started with silicone, which is that kind of easy to work with, but it's easy to work with small scale. Then when you scale it up, it becomes a problem. Which then leads to asking, how hard can it be working with latex? X steps later, 5 years, it turns out to be really freaking hard.
And what is it about latex that you enjoy more?
The fact that you don't need a double-sided mold to make them.
How do you deal with the fragile nature of latex? Have you had any accidents where you've lost an outfit that you made?
I believe that counts as a yes. The major suits I make, it's taken me about 5 years to get them to a working state, whereby I mean they don't explode when you have worn them once. It's been a challenge.
Can you tell me about one of the most elaborate outfits that you've made? How long did it take you to put together, and how long did it take to put on?
This is kind of a typical candidate. The tattoos on this one, reasonably minimal. Just gluing them on is 20 hours or so. A slightly fancier version with textured tattoos. 40 hours of work, something like that. And then the actual outfit, the actual suit itself, about 100 hours, something like that. So, by now I have spent so many hundreds of hours on these, I have no idea how to quantify the work.
That's a lot of dedication. So, when you're starting out with a mold, do you cast something, or do you make the mold yourself?
I make the mold myself.
one of the things I've really admired about your look is you make your hips look amazing. Can you share any tips about how you make your hips look so good?
Thank you for that, Mom. The basics, it does the classical foam pad thing. That's kind of the pure basics. But I have written some stuff on the Facebook page about like the methodology and thinking behind it. There's no real major secret to it besides just taking a bit of a systematic approach to it, I guess.
You get the proportions just right, and that's something that I see a lot of people miss out on, so well done. Well, Elwan, thank you so much for taking the time to speak to us and sharing some of your images. I will definitely be looking forward to seeing more from you in the future.
Thank you for having me.
We will have links to Avalon's many, many websites. She updates weekly with her observations and how her progress is going. It's very interesting. You should definitely check it out.
And you know, that interview went on actually a bit longer than we showed on this podcast. So we will be posting the entire interview later on after this podcast is posted. Check it out.
And if you'd like to be interviewed on a future show, drop us a line and maybe we'll include you then.
Well, Stevie Wonder once said, time is long, but life is short, and it's time to wrap up another episode of Fess Up. Thank you again for watching.
Yeah, we're going to hopefully start getting these out on a regular basis now that the world is returning to normal. We have some exciting plans for our next episode. Meanwhile, if you're interested in buying one of my latex masks, go to maskon.com and check out and see what's going on there. And if you have any comments or suggestions, please put them in the comments section below. We'd love to hear feedback from you.
Can you believe it, Kerry? The next episode will be our 10th episode?
It's pretty crazy, but you guys keep watching. We'll keep making. We'll see you next time.
Bye for now.